are in a chapter called Metals and Non-Metals in Chemistry. One of the easiest chapter to understand, one of the easiest chapter to score marks in the public examination. It is going to fetch you 6 marks in the public examination. There is no hard content in this particular chapter. I started this chapter like this. Matter is made up of elements. Elements are pure substances composed of one type of atoms. Elements are classified as metals and non-metals. Metals are electropositive elements. Non-metals are electronegative elements. Everybody should be able to tell this answer. What are metals? Metals are electropositive elements. Every video, every class, I go on repeating the same content. Why? Because at least in the chapter of metals and non-metals, we should be able to tell what are metals, what are non-metals. Metals are electropositive elements. Non-metals are electronegative elements. Electropositive elements, they are capable of donating electrons during chemical reactions. Electronegative elements, they are capable of accepting electrons during chemical reaction. There is one element. It is a non-metal, but it is capable of donating electrons. Means it is an electropositive element, but it is a non-metal, that is hydrogen. Hydrogen is the only one non-metal which is electropositive in nature. That also I told. The next is how to distinguish between metals and non-metals. To distinguish between metals and non-metals, you have to keep in mind 7 terms, 7 points regarding to the properties of metals. One is metals are in general solids, metals are in general having higher melting points, metals are in general harder in nature, metals are in general lustrous in nature, metals are sonorous, metals are malleable and ductile, metals are good conductor of heat and electricity. Using these 7 keywords, we can distinguish between metals and non-metals, and we are able to list out the properties of metals, properties of non-metals, and differences between metals and non-metals. This is the particular chart going to fetch you marks in the public examination. While developing this chart, we come across number of exceptions. Exceptions, you should be able to list out the exceptions, like mercury is a liquid metal, bromine is a liquid non-metal, gallium and caesium are the 2 metals having lower melting point, diamond is the hardest material but it is a non-metal. Like that, exceptions you should be able to list it out. Then comes to the important part of the chapter, that is called the chemical properties of metals. We are going to learn the properties, the chemical properties of metals under 4 headings. One is reaction of metals with air, reaction of metals with water, reaction of metal with acids, reaction of metals with other metal compounds. So far I completed 2 things, reaction of metals with air, reaction of metals with water. Here we come across number of equations, chemical equations. In chemistry you have to be able to write the chemical equations. And you know how to write the chemical equation, you know the valences, you know the molecular formula, everything I complete. Now we are in a stage where we are going to learn the reactions of metals with acids and reaction of metals with what is known as metal compounds. Here, the textbook, they are not given reactions. Reactions part is over. How easy is it? Some 12 to 14 equations are there so far. We did. These equations are sufficient to score marks, right? And now we are going to learn the 3rd stage, that is reaction of metals with acids. They are not given anything because there is a separate chapter in 10th standard chemistry, that is acids, bases and salts, where we studied the properties of acids. Therefore, in this unit, they are given only one information. That information you have to keep in mind. The content is reaction of metals with acids. If you see the textbook, you don't have any equations, but they are asked you to write some of the equations. We write those equations and understand this particular content in a better manner. In the previous class also I told you, whenever you think about chemical properties, you should know the reactivity chart. I write the reactivity chart. The reactivity chart is reactivity chart. Always you have to remember, all videos, I have written this, you have to practice this. See, the most active metal is potassium, followed by sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, lead. Then we have a non-metal, that is hydrogen, followed by copper, mercury, silver, gold. These are the metals. We are going to learn about the properties of these metals in 10th standard. Here, when I put an arrow mark like this, we can easily understand potassium is the most reactive metal, whereas gold is the least reactive metal in this list of metals. This is a list of electropositive elements. Always remember this list before venturing into the chemical properties of metals or non-metals, right? This is the reactivity chart. Today's class, what we are going to learn, reaction of metals with acids. There is a general statement. Always there should be a general statement. The general statement is like this. Metal. Take a metal. I am writing the general statement, word equation. When a metal reacts with a dilute acid. When a metal reacts with a dilute acid, you get the salt of that metal, metal salt you get, along with that you get a gas called hydrogen. See, this is already I told you regarding hydrogen in the previous class. Hydrogen is a combustible gas, lightest element, atomic number 1. It is collected by downward displacement of what, everything we know. Therefore, we can easily write the general statement. In general, metals react with dilute acid and liberate hydrogen gas. This is the general concept. Then the question arises, acid means, can you name 3 very important mineral acids? The very 3 important mineral acids are, always remember, acids means you should understand, the first one is hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid means HCl. HCl is hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid. The next one is sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid. That is H2SO4. Then standard students should be able to write the molecular formula and be able to tell the name of the acid. These acids are called mineral acids. Commonly used acids in the laboratory. Commonly used acids in the chemistry subject. And another one is, the third one is nitric acid. Nitric acid. These 3 acids you have to always remember. Always you have to remember. Hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid and nitric acid. Some of them in iron acid metal, hydrogen is one, therefore it is monobasic, dibasic, monobasic acid. Like that, they tell, don't worry about all those things. Simply remember, hydrochloric acid HCl, sulfuric acid H2SO4, nitric acid HNO. 3 acids you should know. The general statement is, when a metal reacts with a dilute acid, metal salt and hydrogen gas is released. That is a simple statement. In the textbook they asked you to write the chemical equations of the reactions of magnesium, aluminium, zinc and iron with these acids, with these dilute acids. We write one by one. It is not required. But the textbook they ask, write the equation of magnesium and dilute hydrochloric acid, write the equation of aluminium and dilute hydrochloric acid, write the equation of zinc and dilute hydrochloric acid. They are asked, we write, you can easily write that, because metals react with dilute acid, which gas is going to release, hydrogen gas. I take magnesium, you can also write, you should write this. 3 acids, right?
the chlorophyll acid, hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, nitric acid. What is the molecular formula of hydrochloric acid? HCl. What is the molecular formula of sulfuric acid? H2SO4. The molecular formula of nitric acid is HNO3. See, magnesium reacts with dilute HCl. I write one or two equations. That is not important for you people, why? Because this type of reactions are already written in the chapter called acid, bases and salts. Magnesium and dilute hydrochloric acid, we are going to get a salt of this metal. The salt of this metal is magnesium chloride. You are going to get magnesium chloride, MgCl2. MgCl2 and liberates hydrogen gas. Which gas is released? Hydrogen gas is released. Same way, write about aluminium. Aluminium plus dilute HCl. You are going to get aluminium chloride. Aluminium chloride is AlCl3, because the valence of aluminium is 3. Plus we get hydrogen gas. Which gas releases when an acid, when a dilute acid reacts with a metal? Hydrogen gas. This is about hydrochloric acid. Suppose if you wanted to write about sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid, same reaction, Mg plus dilute H2SO4. You are going to get magnesium sulfate, MgSO4, and liberates which gas? Hydrogen gas. Liberates hydrogen gas. Very nice it is. But next is, when you understand about the particle, if I wanted to write about zinc, zinc plus H2SO4, he rises. So, zinc sulfate, 7SO4, plus liberates hydrogen gas. You can write this type of equation for all metals. What is the general statement? Metal reacts with dilute acid to liberate hydrogen gas and forming metal salt. This is all about we can able to understand even in the textbook. Now see, dilute hydrochloric acid and dilute sulfuric acid reacts with this metal in the same pattern. But see, in this metal, this acid, what is the name of this acid? The name of this acid is nitric acid. Be careful about this acid. When nitric acid, dilute nitric acid reacts with metal, you don't get hydrogen gas. Very important thing we have to remember in this particular part. The very important part is hydrochloric acid, dilute hydrochloric acid reacts with metal, hydrogen gas is released. Dilute sulfuric acid reacts with metal, hydrogen gas is released. But one acid, which is that acid, I write this acid, nitric acid, HNO3, nitric acid. When a dilute nitric acid reacts with a metal, hydrogen gas is not going to obtain. It is not going to release hydrogen gas because nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. Always you have to remember the examination they give us. We are not going to get hydrogen gas when metal reacts with dilute nitric acid. Give reason. Nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. Therefore, when a metal reacts with dilute nitric acid, we are not going to get hydrogen. In this case, what happens? Let us imagine that I write the magnesium. Mg. I make it to react with the dilute HNO3. What happens? We are going to get a nitrate of magnesium. We are going to get this magnesium nitrate. Nitrate valency is 1, magnesium is 2. This is magnesium nitrate. And usually when a dilute acid reacts with a metal, which gas is going to release? Hydrogen gas. Here what happens? that hydrogen gas releases, and since it is a strong oxidizing agent, this nitric acid oxidizes this, therefore the hydrogen becomes water. During the reaction of a metal with the dilute nitric acid, instead of hydrogen, the hydrogen oxidizes into water. Oxidation means what? Addition of oxygen. Hydrogen gets oxygen, it becomes water, and this nitric acid reduces. See, try to understand this. This nitric acid is having three oxygen atoms. One oxygen atom it donates. Therefore, it is an oxidizing agent. The oxidizing agent has to be reduced. Losing of oxygen is reduction. Gaining of oxygen is called oxidation. Here hydrogen is oxidized. Hydrogen is oxidized by the reduction of the nitric acid. Therefore, nitric acid has to be reduced. Therefore, instead of nitrate, NO3 is there, we get a gas of NO2. NO3, one oxygen is gone. That oxygen is gone to water, hydrogen. It becomes water. Therefore, have a clear idea about the reaction of metals with acid. How many acids we are going to deal with? Three acids. Hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, nitric acid. Hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid behave same manner. When a metal reacts with dilute acid, it liberates what? Hydrogen gas. But in the case of a nitric acid, this type of reaction is not going to take place. Why? Because nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. It oxidizes the release hydrogen into water. Oxidizes. Hydrogen gains oxygen, it becomes water. And itself reduces into NO2. NO2 means nitrogen dioxide. Or in this type of reaction, we may get nitrogen dioxide or nitrous oxide or nitric oxide. Any three compounds we are going to get when a dilute nitric acid reacts with what is known as magnesium. But sometimes what happens, if you take very dilute nitric acid, in such cases manganese and magnesium are the two metals, these two metals, magnesium and manganese. These two metals may release hydrogen gas. I repeat it again. In very dilute HNO3 may release hydrogen gas when they react with manganese and magnesium. Otherwise, in all other cases, instead of hydrogen, we get water. Therefore, always remember, among the three acids, hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid and nitric acid, which is a strong oxidizing agent? Nitric acid. Nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. This you have to keep in always mind. Therefore, we are not getting hydrogen. Instead of hydrogen, we are getting water. And nitric acid that gets reduces itself into nitrogen dioxide, nitrous oxide and nitric oxide. In any one of the product, we may be able to get. Therefore, the general statement is like this. When a metal reacts with dilute acid, hydrogen gas is released. Exception is, I told you, chemistry is a subject of exception. Exception is nitric acid. In the case of a nitric acid, this is not true. In the case of nitric acid, we don't get hydrogen, we get water. Because nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. Can you name two metals? But when very dilute nitric acid reacts with these two metals, we may get hydrogen. Otherwise, we don't get hydrogen when dilute nitric acid reacts with a metal, right? One more thing you have to understand here. All metals, see, these are all metals, react with acids, all metals. But after this hydrogen, next metal is which one? Copper. Therefore, copper is less electropositive than hydrogen. Therefore, the question is, dilute acids do not react with copper.
Copper does not react with dilute acids. Therefore, we can wash copper vessels with mild acids. You have seen, copper vessels are washed with tamarind. Tamarind. The copper vessels are used by this type of acids. Why? Because copper does not react with dilute acid, because copper is less electropositive than the hydro. Remember, which metal doesn't react with dilute acid? Answer is copper, mercury, silver, gold. They don't react with dilute acids at all, because all of them are less electropositive than the hydrogen. Above the hydrogen, which are the metals are there, all of them are going to react with dilute acids. But be careful, one dilute acid, which is the nitric acid. In the case of a nitric acid, we don't get hydrogen. Instead of hydrogen, we get water, because nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. See, therefore copper is not going to react with dilute hydrogen. Name the metal which doesn't react with dilute hydrochloric acid. The answer is, don't write gold, you write copper. Copper is a metal which is not going to react with dilute acid. Then comes to the gold. Textbook, they are given one information related to gold. Gold, I write it somewhere here. Gold. Regarding gold, they are given. Gold is a very stubborn metal. It is not going to react with any components of the air, with water, nothing. But when a gold coin is given to you, always, gold is a very soft material. Gold is a very soft metal. If you bite a pure gold coin, you can find the teeth mark. Very soft. Therefore, you can't make ornaments out of pure gold. You can't make ornament out of pure gold, because if you make a pure gold ornament, you can't give any design to that. Therefore, what they do is, they add 8-9% of copper or silver to the gold to make it hard. When it becomes hard, then we can give a design. Therefore, ornamental gold and pure gold are different. Ornamental gold is an impure gold. It is alloy gold. It contains not only pure gold, along with the gold, it may contain copper or silver. Why we are adding copper and silver to the gold? To make it hard. By making it hard, we can give artistic design for the gold by making an ornament. Therefore, ornamental gold is different from pure gold. In Kannada, they may tell, Aparanji Chinna, Suddhavada Chintavana, Aparanji, Nata Karitim. Aparanji Chinna, the Lay Aparana Gramamada, the Kahodilla, Aparana Chinna, Andre, other Lay Chinna, the Jotege, copper, Atava. ಬೆಳ್ಳಿಯನ್ನು ಸಿಲ್ವರನ್ನು ಮಿಕ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡಿರ್ತಾರೆ, ಅದರಿಂದ ಚಿನ್ನ ಗಟ್ಟಿಯಾಗುತ್ತದೆ. ಗಟ್ಟಿಯಾದ ಆಭರಣಗಳನ್ನು ಮಾಡಬಹುದು. ನಾವು ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್, ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ರಿಂಗ್. ವೆನ್ ದಿಸ್ ರಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ದೇರ್, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅ ಪ್ಯೂರ್ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್, ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಗಿವನ್ ಅನ್ ಆರ್ಟಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಡಿಸೈನ್. ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಅ ಪ್ಯೂರ್ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್, ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಇನ್ ಪ್ಯೂರ್ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್ ಆರ್ ಅಲಾಯ್ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್. ದೆನ್ ಹೌ ಟು ಮೆಲ್ಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್, ಹೌ ಟು ಸಪರೇಟ್ ದಿಸ್. Therefore, there is an acid. That acid dissolves gold. That acid dissolves only gold. Which is that acid? That acid is called, I write it here, that acid is called aqua. Aqua regia. Aqua regia is an acid. It dissolves gold. Aqua regia dissolves which one? Gold. To dissolve gold, you require an acid called aqua regia. What is this aqua regia? Aqua regia is a mixture. It is a mixture of HCl. HCl stands for what? HCl is hydrochloric acid, and HNO3, nitric acid. HCl and HNO3 in the ratio 3:1. If you write HNO3 and HCl, you have to write 1:3.
If you write HCl and HNO2, you will have 3:1. 3 part of hydrochloric acid and 1 part of nitric acid put and make a mixture. The mixture is called aqua regia. And aqua regia dissolves gold. Therefore, this acid is used by goldsmith. Goldsmith people, the people that work with gold, they use this acid. That it is a mixture of HNO3 and HCl in the ratio 1:3. HCl and HNO3 in the ratio 3:1. And you write HCl, you have to write 3. HNO3, you write 1 part of nitric acid and 3 part of HCl. We put together, we make an acid and put gold, gold dissolves. But in general, in single acid, gold is not going to dissolve. Therefore, what you have to understand now, what is the content today's reaction of metals with acids. In general, metals react with dilute acid to liberate hydrogen gas. Three mineral acids, hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, nitric acid. Hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid dilute, in dilution, they react with the metal to liberate hydrogen gas. Simple, the right equations. You can write all equations. But be careful about this acid. Nitric acid. When a metal reacts with a dilute nitric acid, you don't get hydrogen gas, because nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. It oxidizes hydrogen into water. There we get water and itself reduces into nitrous oxide, nitric oxide or nitrogen dioxide. Reduction, oxidation, both takes place in this reaction. And therefore, there are some metals, two metals, manganese and magnesium. They may give us hydrogen gas when they react with very dilute nitric acid. And can you, which metal is not going to react with dilute acid? Copper. Copper is not going to react with dilute acid, dilute hydrochloric acid. Then what about gold? Gold is also not going to react with any dilute acids. But there is an acid that dissolves gold. That acid is called aqua regia. Aqua regia is made by the freshly prepared mixture of nitric acid and hydrochloric acid in the ratio 1:3. There we put gold, the gold dissolves. It is called aqua regia. This is regarding the content of reaction of acids and metals. Reactions are not that important, because these reactions already we have written in a chapter called acid, bases and salts. This chapter, metals and non-metals, I completed the chemical properties of metals in air, chemical properties of metals with water, chemical properties of metal with acids, right? Only in the first two parts we have equations. In the third part, that particularly in acids, there is no reaction given in the textbook. But those reactions are already there in the textbook in the chapter called acid, bases and salts. Now we are in the fourth heading of the chemical property, that is reaction of metals. Reaction of metals with other metal compounds. Other metal compounds. Now see children, to understand this, we should understand the reactivity chart properly. Once again, I will show you the reactivity chart. The most reactive metal is potassium. Next is sodium, calcium, magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, lead, hydrogen, copper, mercury, silver and gold. The basic knowledge is, more reactive metal, I repeat, more reactive metal displaces less reactive metal. Very simple. More reactive metal, the metal which is having a ability to react faster. More reactive metal displaces less reactive metal. It is just like a tug of war. A more reactive metal is always able to beat less reactive metal. For example, I tell you, copper sulfate, this they are given, the textbook. Equation is not given, but you have to write the equation. Copper sulfate, it is also called blue vitriol,
it is in blue in color. You take the solute, copper sulfate powder, dissolves it in water, you get a blue solution. And drop or place iron nail in it. In that solution, keep iron nail, iron. Now, here copper sulfate is there, here iron is there, right? See, in copper sulfate, which is the metal, we have copper. And iron is Fe. Between these two metals, which is the more active metal, which is the more reactive metal, that you have to understand with the help of a chart. Chart you know that. See, where is the copper? Copper is here. Where is the iron? Iron is here. Therefore, we can easily understand iron is more reactive than the copper. Iron is more reactive than copper. If a metal is more reactive than the metal present in the compound of the metal, then this metal displaces, means the more reactive metal displaces less reactive metal from the compound. Therefore, reaction takes place. This more reactive metal, what it does is, it takes the negative radical present with the less reactive metal and becomes ferrous sulfate and displaces copper. Copper is displaced. Why copper is displaced? Because copper is less reactive. It is just like two people are there, fighters are there. One fighter is more stronger than the other fighter. The stronger fighter pulls this radical from the less stronger fighter and it becomes ferrous sulfate, and this less the fighter is having less strength, is displaced, is thrown out. Now in between these two, who is more stronger? Iron displaces less reactive. Therefore the statement is, I write the statement here, more reactive metal, you have to write along with me, you have to remember this, more reactive metal displaces, it is a chemical displacement reaction, more reactive metal displaces less reactive metal from its compound. This statement you have to remember, more reactive metal displaces less reactive metal from its compound. Or we can write, more electropositive metal displaces less electropositive metal from its compound. That way also you can write. When copper sulfate plus Fe, E rises to FeSO4 plus Cu. This reaction takes place because iron is more reactive metal, displaces less reactive metal, copper, from the compound of the copper. Now see, if I write the equation like this, chemical reaction like this. Suppose I am having ferrous sulfate, FeSO4. FeSO4 is there. In the FeSO4, if I put copper, can you be able to tell me, is the reaction is going to take place or not? Is it going to take place or not? You have to tell me. See, first concentrate on this. FeSO4 plus copper. Copper is less reactive. Copper is less reactive. Iron is more reactive, therefore less reactive metal cannot displace more reactive metal from its compound. Therefore, in such cases, there is no reaction. We can't find any reaction at all. Why? Because copper, they may ask you, FeSO4 plus Cu, there is no reaction between ferrous sulfate and copper. Give reason. The answer is, copper is less electropositive than the iron, therefore there is no reaction. Or then I ask a question like this, There is a reaction, always there is a reaction between the copper sulfate and iron.
Key reason.
The answer is, iron is more electropositive than the copper, therefore reaction takes place. Because more reactive metal always displaces less reactive metal.
More reactive metal displaces less reactive metal. Less reactive metal cannot displace more reactive metal. Understood that? Very simple it is.
It is just like a theme of the life.
If you study hard, more studying student definitely become more successful than the less studying student.
More reactive metal displaces less reactive.
Understood?
This reaction you have to understand. Here what happened? When you take a test tube, if you put the copper sulfate solution is blue in color. It is blue because it is the complete solution is copper sulfate is called blue vitriol. It is blue in color. Now what you do is you immerse, you put one thread with a help of a thread. Keep iron in. This is a thread. Take a thread, tie iron in and keep it on this. This is a plate. Imagine this is a plate. One thread is there like this. I add one iron nail into the solution of copper sulfate. This is a solution of copper sulfate solution. And this is iron nail. Allow it for 5 hours. What happens? After that, the iron nail starts looking rose red type color. And this copper sulfate solution loses its blue color. It starts looking dull. It decolorizes. The reason is when copper sulfate and iron is more reactive than the copper, therefore it displaces copper. That displaced copper deposits on the iron nail. Therefore, iron light starts looking like the rose red color. The iron line is coated with copper now. And the copper sulfate lost its copper. Therefore, it becomes ferrous sulfate. The ferrous sulfate color is not blue. That thing happens when we immerse the iron line in the solution of copper sulfate solution. The equation is a more reactive, always remember, more reactive, more electropositive metal displaces less reactive or less electropositive metal from its compound. This statement you have to always remember. They may ask the question, why there is a reaction between copper sulfate and iron? Because in this case the reaction takes place because iron is more electropositive than the copper. In this case, ferrous sulfate and copper, there is no reaction. Why there is no reaction? Because copper is less reactive than the what is known as iron. They may ask like this also. Metal, in textbook they are given, metal A plus metal compound B. Give rise as to metal compound A, metal compound A plus metal B, metal B. See here, reaction taking place. Metal A is there, metal B is there, compound of metal B. Metal A is more electropositive than the metal B. Therefore, metal A displaces the compound of metal B and it becomes metal compound A and metal B is displaced. That is the idea of this particular content. Therefore, in the equation, always you have to remember, now we do an activity here. Participate in the activity. I only write the answer, but you have to write and participate here. Suppose, I write an equation like this. I am having calcium sulfate
have calcium sulfate, I drop zinc granules to the solution of copper sulfate. Now you have to tell me, is the reaction is taking place or not? If reaction takes place, you have to answer me why it is going to take place. If reaction is not taking place, then also you have to tell me what is the reason of not taking place of this particular reaction. First activity. Second one is, I am having ferrous sulfate and I put zinc only. Now you have to tell me, is the reaction is going to take place or not? Then I write one more thing, it is, I am having copper sulfate, I drop aluminium, is reaction going to take place or not? One more I write zinc sulfate, I drop copper turnings there, it's inside the solution. If the reaction is going to take place or not, you have to answer me using this chart. And this chart tells us why there are certain metals able to react with certain metal compounds and some of them are not going to react. The reason you have to tell. The reason is very simple. High reactive metal, more reactive metal, more electropositive metal displaces less reactive metal from its compound. That is the statement. More reactive metal displaces less reactive metal from its compound. Now see, first one, calcium sulfate zinc. See calcium and zinc. Between these two, who is more reactive? See calcium, here see the chart. Calcium is here, zinc is here. Between calcium and zinc, who is more reactive? Calcium is more reactive. Zinc is less reactive. Therefore, less reactive metal cannot displace more reactive metal. Understand? Less reactive metal cannot displace more reactive metal. If you study less, you can't get a better job. More, this is less reactive, this is more reactive. Therefore, no reaction. Here, reaction is not taking place. Therefore, you have to write the reason for this. Zinc is less electropositive than the calcium, therefore zinc cannot displace calcium from the calcium sulfate. That is the answer. I repeat once again, how to write the answer? Zinc is less electropositive than calcium. Therefore, zinc cannot displace calcium from calcium sulfate. Now see, ferrous sulfate and zinc, two metals are there. One is zinc, another one is iron. Where is the zinc? Zinc is here, iron is here. When you compare these two, zinc is more reactive. Since zinc is more reactive than iron, reaction takes place. Because zinc is more electropositive than iron, therefore zinc is capable of displacing iron. Therefore reaction takes place. Here we are going to get the zinc sulfate and less reactive metal is displaced. Less reactive metal is, which one is the less reactive metal? Iron is here. Then I ask the reason. What is the reason? Zinc is more electropositive than the iron. Therefore, zinc can displace iron from ferrous sulfate. Next here, copper sulfate and aluminium. Copper and aluminium. Fight between copper and aluminium. See, where is the copper? Copper is here. Where is aluminium? Aluminium is here. See, only you understand. Aluminium is more electropositive than the copper. Therefore, reaction takes place. Therefore, reaction takes place. Since aluminium is more electropositive than the copper, therefore, aluminium can able to displace copper from the copper sulfate. Therefore, it becomes aluminium sulfate. You know aluminium sulfate molecular formula? This is this molecular formula of aluminium sulfate and displaces copper. Displaces copper because aluminium is more electropositive. The next is ZnSO4 plus Cu. See, CeO, if you mix copper, zinc and zinc, see the positions of copper and zinc. Zinc is here, copper is here. Zinc is more electropositive, copper is less electropositive. Since copper is less electropositive than zinc, there is no reaction. No reaction. This is all you have to understand this. You have to write and understand. You can write many compounds of metals and you can drop different metals, you can able to understand. Always remember, more reactive metal only displaces less reactive. This is more reactive. This is more reactive. Reaction takes place. This is less reactive, no reaction. This is less reactive, no reaction. Therefore, the fourth unit of 10th standard chemistry chapter metals and non-metals, that is reaction of metals with other metal compounds. The reaction sometimes takes place, sometimes there is no reaction. The reason is only more reactive, this word, more reactive metal displaces less reactive metal from its compound. That, and one equation always remember, copper sulfate plus Fe. Here, iron is more reactive than the copper, therefore reaction takes place. This reaction already came for the public examination. They asked a question like this. There is a reaction between copper sulfate and iron, but there is no reaction between ferrosulfate and copper. Give reason. The answer is, there is a reaction between copper sulfate and iron because iron is more electropositive than the copper. There is no reaction between ferrosulfate and copper because copper is less electropositive than the iron. Therefore, the reaction takes place in this direction. Reaction cannot take place in this direction. Reverse is wrong. Like this reaction is not going to take place. Reaction should be always takes place in this direction because this is more, this is less reactive. Right? This sense, the chemical properties of metals under four headings. One is reaction of metals with oxygen or A. Second one is with water. Third one is with acids. Fourth one is with other metal compounds.